vision and communications. Very happy to be here this evening, very happy that you are here with INDOT this evening as we continue a conversation with regard to an intersection improvement project. It certainly feels like only last week that we were able to meet and have a conversation and a discussion to talk about intersection improvement. Of course, last week, the focus of the presentation centered around the intersection of State Road 10 and then also Dewey Street and US 31. This evening, however, we're going to focus on the intersection of State Road 110 and US 31. So again, we're happy that you're here with us this evening. We're excited to have an opportunity to present a proposal for your consideration. And again, you'll hear the word proposal quite a bit because that is exactly the purpose of tonight's public hearing is to present a proposal for your consideration and then certainly solicit input, feedback, comment with regards to this proposal. Anything that you'll see here this evening is not a done deal. It is a proposal for consideration. So during tonight's presentation, we're going to talk a little bit about the purpose and need to improve this intersection. We're going to talk about alternatives that INDOT investigated, that we evaluated, that we looked into with regard to the intersection. And then we're going to talk about a preferred alternative that we would like to move forward with in terms of improving the intersection. But again, tonight, the purpose of tonight's hearing is to present a proposal for your consideration this evening. So in terms of the format this evening, hopefully you've had an opportunity as you arrived, you've had an opportunity to talk with members of the INDOT project team. Hopefully you've had an opportunity to view displays and pick up handout information this evening. Certainly one of the focuses in terms of the public hearing this evening is to present information, but then also be able to address questions that you might have in regards to this proposal. I will mention that we have lots and lots of material out in the foyer area. So if you look around the auditorium and you know of folks who would be interested in this information, by all means, feel free to take extra copies of the information this evening. Also, I'll mention a copy of our presentation, all the displays that you're hopefully you're able to view in the foyer area. All of that information has been posted to the INDOT website, so perhaps after the hearing this evening, if you'd like to take a closer look at some of the materials, and sometimes online you can manipulate the sizes, you can really hone in and take a closer look. All of that information is available for review on the INDOT website this evening. In terms of the format, following our formal presentation, which will probably last maybe 20 minutes or so, at the conclusion of our formal presentation, we will transition to our public comment session. As I mentioned at the very beginning, the purpose of tonight's public hearing is twofold. Firstly, it's an opportunity for us to present our proposal. Secondly, and most importantly, it's an opportunity for you to provide comment on that proposal. And so at the conclusion of the presentation this evening, we will transition to our comment period. We'll have an opportunity to present a statement or comment for the INDOT team members, for members of our audience this evening. And so we'll transition to that comment session at the conclusion of the presentation. Next slide, please. So in terms of the intersection, State Road 10 and 110, just a couple of bookkeeping type notes I'd like to mention. A notice of public hearing was published in the local paper, the Plymouth Pilot newspaper. We published our legal notice three times. We also sent out a copy of our legal notice to individuals who happened to be on the project mailing list. Now, if for some reason you did not receive a copy of the legal notice, it simply meant that for whatever reason you weren't on the mailing list. However, by signing in this evening, we will add you to that database so that in future communications, if there are milestones and other update information news that we need to communicate, we'll utilize the sign-in sheets so that we can send you information directly. At this time, I would like to introduce several members of the INDOT team. I'll probably just introduce our speakers and the gentleman that you'll hear from during our presentation this evening. Many of our team members are probably still out in the foyer area, so we won't introduce all of those names, but I would like to introduce Matt Deichley, who is to my right. Matt is our of Communications for La Porte District Office. The La Porte District, they coordinate planning, project development, project delivery, maintenance activities for Northwest Indiana. So we're happy that Matt is here, and we'll hear from Matt in the next several minutes. Also, representing the Troyer Group, which is the firm that is under contract with INDOT for environmental analysis, design, engineering, and activities, we have Chris Weimer, who is with the Troyer Group, and we'll hear from Chris. Troyer, they were responsible for some of the very lovely displays that hopefully you had an opportunity to review in the foyer area this evening. At this time, I'd also like to recognize our elected and our local officials. Certainly, we're happy and very pleased that they are here this evening to engage with you and engage with NDOT and participate as part of the discussion in regards to this proposal. So I'd like to recognize our elected and local officials at this time. With us this evening, we have Senator Randy Head, who's with us in our auditorium. Senator Head, thank you so much for being here. We also have Senator Ryan Mishler, who is here with us this evening. Senator Mishler, thank you so much for being here, sir. Also with us this evening in our audience, we have Representative Jack Jordan, who is in our audience. Representative Jordan, thank you so much for being here. We appreciate that very much. We also have several other elected and local officials who are in our audience this evening, representing our officials from our county level, our local levels. We have Susan Hombaugh, who is on the Argos Town Council. I know I was corrected several times last week. All right, thank you, ma'am, for being here, Councilwoman. Also, we have John Grillich, Marshall County Board's office. So, thank you so much, sir, for being here. We also have Paul Stearns. Paul Stearns, part of the Argos Redevelopment Corporation. These were the elected local officials that I was able to ascertain by picking up the sign-in sheet list as we arrived this evening. However, there may be additional local and elected officials in our audience, and so we want to take just a moment to recognize if we have other local and elected officials in our audience this evening. If they'd be so kind as to just introduce themselves, sir.
Kevin Ockmeyer, Washington County Commissioner.
Commissioner, thank you so much for being here, sir.
Brian Lewis, Fulton County Commissioner.
Commissioner. Good. Thank you so much for being here, sir. Additional local and elected officials? Yes, sir.
Dustin Johnson, Argos Town Council.
Council, thank you so much for being here. Yes, ma'am.
Lisa Mulaney, Clerk Treasurer, Town of Argos.
Thank you so much for being here. See. Don't want to overlook any of our local officials. Very good. All right, well, with that, as an introduction, we're going to proceed forward with our presentation this evening. If you were with us last week, the presentation may seem a bit familiar, but we did incorporate some different slides really to be specific to the State Route 110 intersection. And so we're happy and pleased again to arrive at this milestone and look forward to receiving comment after the presentation this evening as we continue the discussion regarding how to improve and enhance the intersection. Next slide, please. So when you look about the room, many of us represent stakeholders. All of us in this room are stakeholders. And so part of NDOT's charge in terms of proposing an improvement to an intersection is to consider all the various stakeholders who might be impacted by the improvement. And so probably when you look on this slide, you know, there are probably many more stakeholders that aren't even listed. And so part of NDOT's charge is to first propose a project that will enhance safety, and safety. Then secondly, look at those enhancements and also think about how will the proposed action impact the various users, the various stakeholders, the people that will be using, traveling to and from that particular intersection. So we've been trying to make sure that we have two thoughts in mind that are paramount. That's a safety enhancement project and how will it impact users. Next slide, please. So in terms of this particular graphic, it's just an illustration of kind of where we are in our project development process. The yellow boxes at the bottom kind of denote kind of the milestones in terms of public engagement. Many of you probably were with us in June when we met at the town council offices for an informational meeting. The second yellow box in the middle that kind of denotes that we're at the public hearing stage. Really what the difference between the public hearing and the informational meeting we had in June is that now we're at a more critical decision-making point. At the time of public hearing, right now we have a draft environmental document that is out for public review. So whenever that draft environmental document is released for public involvement, INDOT then holds a public hearing to talk about some of the impact that might be associated with the proposed improvement. And so the third yellow box is going to be a communication box. You know, no matter what happens, no matter if the project advances or if there's something else that might happen in terms of the proposed project, our charge is to make sure that we are communicating a decision. You've been very gracious with your time speaking with us this evening. Last week, a lot of you attended the meeting in June, so we want to make sure that we perform our due diligence to make sure that we communicate a decision, whatever that decision might be. And so that's denoted in that third box. And so the blue box is just kind of shows some of the milestones along the way that have to occur in terms of developing this proposal. Certainly, this project, there's a federal component in terms of funding, there's a state match component in terms of funding, and so there are milestones that have to be completed in order to arrive at this particular point that we are this evening. Next slide, please. So in terms of this, as I mentioned previously, this environmental document, what is the significance of this document? Well, basically, the environmental document is part of a decision-making process. And so, INDOT, state DOT, we follow all federal state regulations and guidelines, and one of those federal guidelines is to develop an environmental document so that you can develop a clear purpose and need for what you're trying to accomplish. As part of that requirement for the environmental document, you have to also develop alternatives. So that kind of the goal is so that a DOT cannot just arbitrarily arrive at a decision to improve an intersection, improve a road. There has to be steps that have been followed. You have to have a clear purpose and need. You have to have alternatives to compare against that purpose and need. So INDOT has developed an environmental document. We've released that environmental document for public involvement. And so that's kind of why we have to have the public hearing this evening, so that we can make sure that we adhere to those federal regulations. Next slide, please. So in terms of this proposed intersection improvement, one of the core criteria before we can even propose a plan of action is to develop a clear purpose and need. Kind of the purpose and need for this particular project is to enhance safety. This is a safety enhancement project. So safety, first and foremost, is the purpose of the project, to enhance safety through the intersection of 110 and US 31. The need for the proposed action at this time is to reduce the number of accidents at the intersection, and furthermore, enhance safety. And so as our purpose and need is developed, enhancing safety at the intersection, reducing the number of accidents at the intersection. Next slide. So in terms of this proposed action, and again, falling in line with the environmental document and having to establish a purpose and need, having to establish alternatives. So these are the four alternatives that INDOT investigated and looked into and evaluated as a part of the development of the environmental document. The first alternative is the no build. Now the no build alternative always has to be considered, always has to be evaluated as an alternative. No build basically is the alternative. It reads just like it says. No build. What would happen if INDOT simply did not improve the intersection? No build alternative. Now, would that no build meet the purpose and need? Would that no build enhance safety at the intersection? Would that no build alternative reduce the number of accidents? And so we looked at that. The next alternative that we investigated was the signalized intersection. So we compare the signalized intersection with our purpose of need, enhancing safety, reducing the number of accidents. One of the considerations that we took into place with the signalized intersection is just the traffic east-west on State Road 110. Just not having enough traffic coming across in an east-west movement did not warrant a signalized intersection. So we looked at that particular alternative and determined that it would not necessarily meet the purpose and need of the project. The next alternative that we investigated was an interchange. What would an interchange do at this particular intersection? How would that meet our purpose and need? Would that enhance safety? Would that reduce the number of accidents? Well, when you look at interchange, it would enhance safety. It would reduce the number of accidents. However, in terms of an interchange, it requires a significant amount of time in terms of planning, in terms of design, in terms of implementation. So there's a time consideration that is associated with the construction of an interchange. But many individuals have asked the question, well, would an interchange enhance safety? Of course, the answer is yes, it absolutely would. However, but you have to take that into consideration with the timing that it would require for planning, development, implementation. So then we look at this J-turn intersection, all right? So let's look at the J-turn and compare that against our purpose and need of enhancing safety, reducing the number of accidents. And with the J-turn alternative, this would meet our purpose and need. It would reduce the number of accidents, and it would certainly enhance safety by limiting or prohibiting, I should say, that east-west movement and being able to directly cross US 31. And so these are the four alternatives that I did not look into, that we've investigated, we've evaluated as part of the development environmental document. All of these alternatives are explained in great detail. We have a copy of our environmental document in the foyer. If you'd like to read the document and look into our explanation in terms of each one of the alternatives, that information is available in the foyer this evening. Next slide. So project resource locations, this is also where you can view copies of the environmental documents. This is also where you can view information with regards to the preliminary design plans and other information. Our website is also a great repository for information as well. Next slide. All right, this time I'm going to introduce Chris Wagner, who is again with the Troyer Group. Chris is going to walk us through some of the design detail in terms of the of INDOT's preferred alternative. Chris.
Thank you, Ricky.
So the first thing we look at, and this is a safety improvement project, is the crash history at the intersection. The history we're showing is for the last 4 years. And that is showing that there is crash fatalities without injury, 15 total, 9 incapacitating injuries, 7 total. Incapacitating injuries, so significant injury, 7, a rate of 4. Luckily, no fatalities through this stretch. Although as mentioned many times, we were out there that there had been fatalities at this intersection. We never went over. So a total of 26 through the four-year span. The main reason that has been cited in all those accident reports that the police gave is that the crash is most often involved through movements or left turns, and usually on the end, basically when they're almost about to get across the intersection, but that's when they're getting hit. The intersection So the intersection is on a curve. It is also skewed. So those are also bad elements about the intersection. And then again, there is a good amount of traffic crossing US 31 at this location. One of the big reasons, or one of the main causes of these types of intersection or crashes at intersections, is on the existing intersection, just like at the State Road 10 intersection, there is basically a middle median where most of those vehicles that are trying to go through or turn to the left are queuing, or basically trying to get in that position so that they can cross the traffic. A J-turn essentially moves those queue points or those movements so that they are not combating each other. They each have their own place to stack up and cross the intersection. That is the real crux of a J-turn intersection. This is what's shown. So if you were trying to go through on the side road, you take a right turn on a US 230 or US 31, you then get over into the left lane to make your J-turn. You would then make that left turn when there is traffic, an opening in traffic on 31, and then proceed to make your left turn or your U-turn, and then take a right turn back onto the side road. If you were to take a left turn, it's the same thing, except you would continue on 31. In our design, these are about 1,000 feet away, so it gives you time to get onto 31, get to speed, and trucks. The difference is shown again in these red dots. So basically at a standard intersection on a divided highway, there are 24 crossing conflict points. This is where a car is conflicting another car at either a T-bone or head-on location. So there's 24 in a standard intersection. That is reduced to 4 on a J-turn. The number of merging conflict points is 10 on the 51 and 10 on the J-turn. So this is where both vehicles are basically merging into traffic, they're merging into the common way, and those accidents are most likely to be rear-end accidents. Then you have 8 diverging accidents on the existing and 10 on the J-turn. That's when a vehicle all of a sudden stops in front of you to turn right or turn left at their destination, and the people behind you are not ready for it. So, crash studies have been done on J-turns throughout the nation, and they show a reduction of 38% on rear ends. So again, really not really removing the merging or diverging, so that's not that big of a reduction. However, the angle turning and turning ones are great reductions. So angle, 100% reduction, turning, 69% reduction. Side swipe, again, 63 is still good, but it's not as much as the angle where the conflict points are really hard to high. And the injury is reduced by 82%, fatalities 50%. This again is the main conflict points where there's T-bones or head-on collisions, those are really being reduced. That's being shown that in also the injury being reduced. So the layout of the intersection. You're coming up on 0 to 10, or kind of with 800, you get up to 31. You now will have a center median that will limit you from crossing US 31 at that location. Before you get up there, there will be signage, diagrammatic signage, that similar to what an interchange has, that it tells you to turn right to get to the J-turn. Basically turn right, it will then show you making the J-turn, and then either proceeding to your left for the left turn, or again making a right to finish your through move. The median crossovers for the J-turns are 1,000 feet apart. We are planning to extend the right turn lanes to get to the J-turns. That will aid big vehicles in their turning movements so that there's room for interstate semis, triple semis, farm equipment to make that. Currently, we are not extending the left turns to the intersection already. That could be something that we added. That was something that was added at the state of the 10. This just shows a close-up at the eastern J-turn showing a truck. So a truck would basically give you the left turn lane, very similar to what they do now. This is past the intersection. They would then wait until there's an acceptable gap to make their J-turn, or make their U-turn. They can do that under yield conditions, so if there's low traffic, they can make that without stopping, or if they have to stop, they would stop and then make their move. We are also showing that the left turns onto the side road from the main line are not being impacted at all. So there's a truck train movements in our template showing those semis making that maneuver. Also, right turns out of the main, off the side street are not being impacted either. So really it's just the side streets, through movements, and left turns that are being changed with this design. And it's the same thing shown on the west side, very similar to the one on the other side. Recent case study, this was put in 2.5 years ago, US 41 and State Road 114. And the crashes were reduced from nearly 2 to 0. But there was significant accidents at that location. 114, just to the east of this, is the busiest landfill in the state. So they have a lot of truck traffic at this location. The cross traffic is very similar to State Road 110 and also State Road 10. US 41 does have different traffic than US 31. It is less than in US 31. But now we'd like to go over Some comments that we received at the June information meeting, everything that's in bold is what we received as public comments. And I'd like to turn over the interchange one to Matt.
So, like Chris was saying, just like last week, what we wanted to do was go through some of the frequently asked questions or comments that we heard back in June, which also we heard some of the same thing just last week for the 010 public hearing. So one of the top one here is the public safety preference for an interchange. The purpose of the project here, you can see, is the safety, to improve safety immediately as quick as possible. So the J-turn intersection can be put in one construction season. As Chris was mentioning earlier, the interchange is going to take several years of planning. It's substantially more expensive by about 1/20 of the cost as the J-turn. But the important thing here that we really need to mention is the J-turns and the interchanges have virtually the same crash reduction that we're looking to do here. So from a safety standpoint, whether it's an interchange or whether it's a J-turn, there's virtually the same crash reduction here, which is what we're intending to do. We also need to mention too that this isn't going to prohibit us from putting interchange in the future by putting a J-turn in now. We can still accommodate that if traffic volumes or funds support that in the future. So that's a possibility still in the future if it warrants it. I want to talk a little bit about US 31 upgrades. So you may have heard that there is a plan in place to look into US 31 upgrades. So we're developing that strategy right now. There's a study going on through the end of this year for the entire corridor to see what possible changes may be coming. So potential location, interchanges you can see right there, traffic volume, safety, access, cost, and consistency with regional road networks. So those are some of the selection, the reasons why we would select something for a particular interchange in that situation. But right now, specifically, while the study's going on and while future planning is happening, right now what we're doing is immediate operations and safety concerns we're addressing right now with low cost, but also short-term solutions here, and that's what the J-turn does. Again, virtually the same crash reduction here, so we're seeing the safety improvements that we would see if we had interchange as well. So it's really important to note that. And again, the future of whether the J-turn stays or goes, if there's an interchange that's possible in the future, we can still put that into the J-turn there. So, but again, I just really want to stress to everyone, it's one of the biggest concerns we've heard last week and in previous weeks, was the crash reductions. But again, J-turns, interchanges, they're virtually the same. It's the percentage, one percentage point off in terms of crash reductions. So, turn it back over to Chris.
Thank you, Matt. Maneuverability of large vehicles will be increased. Basic semis, livestock, trailers, farm equipment, school buses. So just like on the stairway 10, we ran simulations or our analysis to see if those can make the maneuvers. So this is a interstate semi, which is roughly about 60, 70 feet long, making the J-turn. A triple trailer, making the J-turn.
Triple trailers are not allowed on state highways in Indiana. They're only allowed on the toll road. You keep saying that, but it doesn't matter. They're not allowed here.
Understood. Again, answering comments. These are comments that were given to us. The combine and school bus. Another one, and this was a case study, Purdue filmed the U.S. 41 and Stable 114 J-turn to see maneuverability, how the trucks handle that. The video is playing on the foyer. It is at 10 times speed, but if anybody wants to look at that, they can. So economic impact will result from restriction of truck access. Again, the truck access will remain basically the same as it is now. There will be a time increase for people for traffic to once across. In our simulations, that was an average of 30 seconds. That simulation was done where everything was a stop condition. So a vehicle came to US 31 and stopped. It then got on the US 31, got to the J-turn, and stopped. And then turned on the J-turn, and then before going to make its right, back on the state road 110. In actuality, all those would be yields, so they could be quicker than the 30 seconds. This is our simulation. The simulation is also running out in the foyer for anybody to view that or ask questions. So, proposed configuration will maintain or improve capacity of the intersection. So the existing capacity of the intersection is given in a level of service for an intersection. And levels of service are based on how much time, on average, a vehicle will be delayed or stopped at the intersection. The existing condition is between a B and a C. So sometimes it's a B, sometimes it's a C, depending on the movements. The proposed condition is mostly B's with one C. So virtually the same, maybe slightly better as far as capacity. And in B, level of service is roughly 11 to 15 second delay or wait time at that intersection is to be expected. And that is very good. Generally, the threshold is level service D, so when you start looking if you're in a signal and lanes or roundabout, same thing, and additional capacity. Project purpose is to reduce travel time between South Bend and Indianapolis. Not really doing anything to US 31 is currently has free flow through the intersection, and the proposed condition will have the same free flow condition, so it's basically the same. Emergency vehicle response across US 31 will take longer. Again, we are showing a potential delay of average of about 30 seconds, and again, that's a vehicle stopping at each one of those locations. Emergency vehicle, they have the lights going, they have the right of way. If people yield to them, they should be able to cross it much quicker than that, but that's what our simulation is based off of. J-turn will not accommodate horse and buggy traffic. J-turn will maintain the refuge area off US 31 travel lanes. This was more from the 010. We can, again, as I presented, we can increase the length of those left turn lanes to get to state route 110. In which case, a horse and buggy, which they do now, they basically cross US 31 in the center median, that's their refuge area, they then wait, then they cross again to get across. They would cross US 31 to get to that left turn refuge area. If we extend into it, it would be basically the same thing, just across. They would then proceed in the left turn lane, get to the J turn, cross the traffic, and then proceed in the right turn lane off in the shoulder. So not in the through traffic on US 31. US 31 traffic volumes are too high for a J-turn. They have been implemented successfully on four-lane highways that have the same, if not more, traffic than in US 31. US 31 has roughly 15,000 cars per day. Missouri has put them on where the main traffic is 1.5 times. Maryland, 2.5 times the traffic of US 31. And then Michigan, 5.5 times the traffic of US 31. Now, there's lots of other circumstances with these J-turns in these other states. Some of them may have signalized intersections associated with the J-turn. That was a comment brought up. We then did some more research. Again, we were listening to your comments. And there are many J-turn intersections in states where it's the same thing, where it's basically they have stop or yield control to get across four-lane interstates, divided highways, to have more traffic. One in Minnesota that is carrying roughly 40,000 vehicles per day, and the cross street has 1,000, similar to State Road 110. But we have that information in a handout if anybody wants that.
Very good. Thank you, Chris, for that information. This particular slide, we're trying to show our proposed project schedule. And again, keep in mind that what you're seeing this evening is a proposal for consideration. It is in fact a preferred alternative, as we've explained earlier in the presentation. But this is a proposed schedule in terms of if this alternative were to be carried forward, we would again be able to deliver the proposed improvement next year, 2018. Certainly there's some other milestones that would need to occur, but if the proposal were to advance, then this is what the schedule would look like in terms of delivering the improvement project for State Route 110. Next slide, please. So the date that you see on the slide behind you, Friday, October 13th, INDOT would respectfully request that if you'd like to submit comment in regards to this proposal, that you submit those comments to us by October 13th. One of INDOT's charges in terms of holding the public hearing this evening is that we must produce a transcript, a public hearings transcript. And in that transcript, it will contain comments that we hope to receive over the next several minutes during the public comment session, comments we hope to receive over the next several weeks via email, U.S. mail, the comment forms, which I'll mention. There's one page sheet in the foyer area. Hopefully everyone had an opportunity to grab one, but it actually just lists the ways that you can submit comments to INDOT. Our email address, mailing address, other information is there as well. But we're respectfully requesting those comments be submitted by the 13th of October so that we can put together a transcript. The public hearings transcript is a really important document. It's a document that will be presented to the project team, to INDOT officials, and in part be used as part of the overall decision-making process. And so it's very important that if you participate this evening, and even if you choose not to participate this evening, utilize the other options to submit comments to INDOT so that we can put together a transcript. Also mentioned that public hearings transcript can be requested. It's a public record, through a public records request. It's a public document, can be requested once it's been finalized and it's been developed. So again, I'll mention that by Friday, October 13th, and that is again so that INDOT can put together a transcript and so that can be presented to INDOT officials, and so in part, decisions can be made in terms of moving forward. Next slide, please. So in terms of next steps, well, certainly we're having the public hearing this evening, but one of the immediate next steps is to receive public comment from you, from others who would be interested in this proposed improvement. And then once we put together a transcript, and then INDOT official review, and then decisions are made, the next part of our next step is to communicate a decision. Very important. You've been very gracious with your time this evening, so we want to make sure that whatever is carried forward, that we communicate it clearly, concisely, so that you're not wondering, hey, I went to that public hearing a couple months ago, I haven't heard from INDOT since, what's going on? And we want to make sure that we're communicating a clear message, regardless of what the outcome is in terms of moving forward or whatever the outcome may be. Make sure that we communicate that. So again, if you do not have an opportunity to sign in, please, by all means, feel free to do so. Next slide, please. Very well, this is our very last slide. It's just showing our report district page and web address. That address behind me is where you can find copies of all the information that's been presented this evening, the maps and displays that are visible in the foyer area. So this time we're going to transition to our public comment session. At the beginning of the presentation, I mentioned that there are two main purposes for the INDOT public hearing. First, it's an opportunity to present a proposal for consideration. Secondly, and most importantly, it's an opportunity to receive comment and input from you as stakeholders, people that have a stake in terms of what will happen at State Road 110 and US 31. And so this time we're going to transition to our comment session. During the comment session, this is an opportunity for you to participate. You've listened to us talk for the last 35 minutes or so. So now it's an opportunity for you to present a comment and regards to perhaps what you've seen in the presentation, perhaps some information you might have viewed out in the foyer. So what we've done is we've had speaker schedules that were listed and posted outside of the foyer area, and we've asked that simply if you arrived this evening knowing that you wanted an opportunity to participate as a speaker, to sign in. Even if you did not sign in as a speaker, that's okay. You'll have an opportunity, certainly afford an opportunity for anyone who would like to speak. But we'll begin with the speakers who signed in on our speakers' schedule. Now, if you were with us last week, you already know why this stoplight is here. You already remember probably why we had the stoplight here. We have a significant number of speakers, a number of individuals who've requested an opportunity to speak. And to make sure and ensure that we accommodate all of our speakers and those who may not have signed in to speak, that perhaps haven't heard our speakers may want to speak, we're going to institute or utilize a time limitation system. See, how are we going to do that? We're going to utilize the stoplight. So when your name is called and you begin presenting your comments for the public record this evening, you will see a, no, I won't say red light, I'm gonna say green light first. So the green light just denotes, hey, this is your time to begin speaking, presenting your comments for inclusion into the comment session this evening. Last week, we implemented a 2-minute time limitation for our speakers, and respectfully, all of our speakers adhere to that time limitation. We were able to accommodate everyone on our speaker schedule, plus a number of individuals who did not sign in but wanted to speak, having heard everybody speak. So, at the beginning of your time, you're going to see green light. At about 1:30, green light's going to disappear. This yellow light's going to appear. Yellow light denotes that there's approximately 30 seconds or so to begin to conclude your presentation, your notes for this evening. And at the end of that 2-minute time limit, you're going to see this red light. And we all know what the red light means. Red light is an indication that your time has elapsed. And please conclude your comments so that we can certainly accommodate the next speaker. So we're going to utilize the time limitation again this week as we utilized it last week, the last week's public hearing. As is the case with any INDOT public hearing, we always afford an opportunity to our elected and local officials to present their comments before we open it up to the other speakers who have signed in on our speaker schedule. So we're asking our elected officials to sign in on a blue sheet of paper, that indication that you're an elected or local official. We have a microphone and a freestanding microphone here, which we probably should make sure that we're on and live. But we're going to ask our speakers to utilize the microphone, freestanding, they can address members of our INDOT team, or if you'd like to direct your comments towards the audience, the choice is yours. But just keep in mind the 2-minute time limitation that we'll utilize, and again, that is just to accommodate as many speakers. Also, I'll mention real briefly, even if you participate as a speaker, by all means, please feel free to supplement your verbal comments this evening with written statements. Written statements, emails, letters, even if you participate as a speaker, feel free to utilize the other options to submit your comments as well. So with that as an introduction, and again, we have a number of speakers who have signed in. Our schedule will begin with our elected local officials first. And our first speaker to sign in on our speaker schedule this evening, the State Senator Randy Head. He'll be our very first speaker. Senator Head, if you make your way towards the microphone there, we're going to just begin our session this evening.
You're highly intelligent. I think you care about safety. I appreciate a lot of what INDOT does around the state, and up until these projects, I've had good relationships and good things going on with INDOT, and I represent them in the state Senate. I say up to this because this is a horrible proposal. I don't have a problem with you, I have a problem with the agency. I want to direct my problems to the agency. I don't mean for it to be personal. But when you say it's a proposal, virtually no one in this community believes you. Virtually everyone believes it is a done deal and that you are vested in it and you have made up your minds to do this. Virtually everyone believes you are here because you have to adhere to the federal regulations and not because anything we say makes any difference to the agency whatsoever. And that's a problem. I had 2 private meetings with INDOT about J-turns, and another public meeting and another representative. You're trying to put 6 of them that I know in my district, which is all the 6 counties and parts of 3 others. And it's been handled the same way every time. You took public comments in June to come back to tell us why the people who live here and have to pay for this and have to use it are wrong. And everyone believes that that's the purpose of you listening to those public comments. Local officials in Marshall County have done a fantastic job. I arranged for a meeting with them in Indianapolis shortly after our session ended. They have economic development plans for the town of Argos. They want to build an industrial park. It will bring in more trucks, bringing goods to and from. It will bring in more cars for workers. They want to have a frontage road for more businesses to bring in yet more cars. And it is amazing to me that the bad news isn't that our jobs are going to China or our jobs are going to Mexico. It's that the state government we pay for is interposing itself between our wishes and the reality they're going to force us to accept. And it's wrong.
Amen.
Not come in part because of the J-turn, not entirely, and I don't want to overstate that. But this is the gateway to the town of Argos. And so many communities across our state say, our jobs are leaving, someone else ought to do something. But this town and this county got together and said, we're going to do something about it. We're going to build our own industrial park and take our future in our own hands. And it's INDOT that is helping to stymie that. It's INDOT that's getting in the way of that. And it's disheartening. These are the people who pay for this and who have to use it. And they don't want it. They don't want it. No one in my district, well, there are a few, but overwhelmingly, people do not want these J-turns. I wonder if I was approaching an intersection and a sign said there have been 25 wrecks in recent years at this intersection, all from left-turning cars. Would I slow down? You bet I would. Whether I was on 31 or 10, you bet I would. I'm guessing the people in this community would accept an interchange at 10 and an overpass at 110, but that's not on the list of alternatives we consider, and I don't understand it. Overwhelmingly, the people in my district have always felt like people in Hamilton County and Marion County matter more to state government. And we don't see it putting J-turns there, we see it putting them here, and it reinforces that perception. I meant what I said at the beginning, sincerely, that I don't have anything against you personally, and maybe it seems like I do, because I get excited. But I think your traffic count is during the week, and we have Notre Dame games, we have Culver at the Academy, we have the lake, we have tourists, and the traffic counts go way up. We have economic development projects that work to drastically alter and improve the future of this community. And I feel that what you are doing is wrong. You say this is a proposal. Prove to us it's a proposal. Don't give us the red light tonight. Give this proposal the red light. The town of Argos, the people who live here and who pay for this, are overwhelmingly telling you, do not do this to us. And we impose taxes on them, and we make them give us money, and then we do what they don't want. Gentlemen, I say to you with all respect, this is just wrong.
Our next speaker to sign in as an elected official this evening, our next speaker will be State Representative Jack Jordan. Representative Jordan, thanks so much for being here again today.
Thank you, Senator
Debs.
Just so you know, Senator Debs has done a lot behind the scenes with the commissioner, with various INDOT officials. He's really spearheaded the effort and set up a lot of meetings for us. And we've talked to a number of state officials. I'm not going to repeat what Senator Head just said because it's ditto, ditto, ditto. But the thing that frustrates me is that we have had, for the last decade, we've had a bold plan put together for the US 31 Coalition. There have been people that have worked together with towns, with the county, with the state. Kevin Overmeyer, how many trips have you made to Indianapolis on the US 31 Coalition?
I go down to 421.
Well, it was down to 421. But as far as on a coalition level, they have finally got together a consensus among all these officials and have worked hard for years and years and years with this bold plan to make 31 a logistics corridor for our economy, for our safety, for our future success. And then you turn around and tonight I see, again, nothing against you, that you're starting a process to see what we want 31 to look like. That's already been done. The bold plan is out there. We've got it in place. And so I would just ask to go back to what the US 31 Coalition has put together. It doesn't include J-turns. It includes a plan that makes 31 great for industry, great for safety, great for community, that aligns with what the people and taxpayers want. So I would just plead with you to go back to that plan because a lot of work has been done over the last decade. And I might add that Governor Daniels was aligned with that plan. Governor Pence was aligned with that plan. Governor Holcomb has stated commitment to that plan. So I don't understand where this is coming from as far as why now we're deviating from that plan. So let's stick to the hard work that's been done in the last decade and move ahead with the US 31 Coalition of Recommendations.
Very well said. Thanks, State Representative Jordan from Wisconsin. Our next speaker on our elected public officials list this evening will be John Krillich, who is representing the Marshall County Governor's Office. Mr. Krillich, the floor is now yours.
Thank you. That's close. It's growing. appreciate the fact that you're concerned with the environment. I have a lot of friends in Argos, and certainly their life, their safety is important. Your one slide that showed zero fatal accidents at State Road 110. In April or May, we had an 11-month-old baby that was killed in a traffic accident there. So there are accidents there. More accidents out here. We need to address that. The J-turn, I see a semi going across all lanes of traffic. I can only imagine what a car or a person's going to look like in that car once they drive underneath that semi-trailer. It's ugly. I've seen it. We need to take a look at the value of the dollar. And when I say the value of the dollar, I'm talking about associated with safety. Certainly, economic impact is important. My concern is life safety. I've been involved with a couple of life safety issues in our county. They've been very positive. Please don't make this one negative. One of the things that I ask at the time of a fatality is whose name do I put on the death certificate as a contributory factor? That's important. I'm the guy that has to talk to family members that says, your loved one was killed in a traffic accident. I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for those comments. Our next speaker to sign in on our elected officials' speaker sign-in this evening will be Paul Stearns, President of Argos Redevelopment Corporation. Mr. Stearns, the floor is now yours.
Thank you again for coming here and speaking with us, presenting your concerns. Our concerns are this, from an economic standpoint. You're not only cutting off potential customers to Argos businesses at 10 and at 110 because they do come in from that direction. But the people in our Amish and Mennonite community to our southern border here along Fulton and Marshall County, their businesses, mainly located along Michigan's road, those people come off of 110. You're not helping your customers get to them, and their economic livelihood is now at stake. Because of an INDOT decision, they don't get a say in, because they will not come to this meeting. You're not making it easy for their hooks and buggies to get across that plains. I watch it every Sunday. Your plan, your grand plan is to close all these county roads. That's your upgrade. Your traffic count at that intersection will climb. The interactions with those horse and buggies will climb. You have no plan for that. Those concerns need to be taken into account. I have also been doing some research. I'm going to step out of the economic and bring you people up today. These people in DOT are not just planning these J-turns at 10 and 110. Every meeting they've had in Peru, Miami County, 18 and 218, the crowd was against you, yet you continue. 24 in Cass County, Logansport, the crowd was against you, yet you continue. I'm deaf, guys. I'm almost completely deaf just today, but you're more deaf to our concerns now. You've explained you want to do this in two intersections over towards Allen County. Again, they're against you. To my elected officials here, you hold these guys as purse strings. Tell them no, because your constituents are telling them no, and they're not listening. The experiment at 41 and 114 is not over. You've had, what, 1-2 years of data. People's driving habits change. They're going to get used to that intersection, and they're going to get turned to being overconfident again, and your accident rates will climb, and it will be worse than what they are now. My other concern is this, snow removal. I got talking to a couple of truck drivers at work. Every single one of them signed a petition this week against it. Are they going to plow this? Because your plan is always the plan to plow the travel lane, then the passing lane, then the intersections. This is the, no longer an intersection. This is extension of 10 and 110. What's your plan? Your slides have nothing for this. That's a safety concern. I've seen slide offs at these intersections during the winter. They're not nice. All this is to do one thing, and that's what your sixth to the last slide said. To speed up the time, or shorten the time, I should say, from South Bend to Indianapolis by 20 minutes. I think Fulton, Marshall County, Argos, and Rochester's economic livelihood is more important than getting from South Bend to Indianapolis 20 minutes sooner. Thank you.
Those comments. Our next speaker to sign in on our speaker schedule for elected local officials will be Susan Onbaugh, Argos Town Council. Susan Onbaugh in the audience. And again, I'll mention again, for any of our speakers, even if you present a presentation or present comments this evening, by all means, please supplement those verbal comments or written statements as well. Ms. Onbaugh, the floor to you.
It's Suzanne Onbaugh. I am not for the J-turner. I'm not going to get into the particulars of the traffic and how it operates. This is more on how I feel, and I believe the community feels, about this whole project. We feel this hearing is a legal formality only. It's a sham. We can speak, but our words have no bearing on the decision, because it's already been decided and scheduled. We might as well stand up here and recite nursery rhymes for all the good it will do. Do you know how that makes us feel as community members? We feel irrelevant. We feel insignificant. We feel like second-class citizens of Indiana. The state has decided our future for us. Because yes, this will impact our future. It will have an effect on our community. We're working hard to move forward. We're working on our industrial park. We're working on housing. We are working on many areas within this community, and this is not going to be helpful. It's going to be detrimental. I understand safety. I acutely understand safety after losing a great niece to an accident a few months ago. Even one fatality is one too many. It was not at this intersection, but I understand. But we must also keep our community alive. We are trying hard, and it's important to keep this community alive. I don't understand why other communities have these fantastic interchanges and these roads. I mean, they're amazing. You go down to Carmel, Indianapolis. You say you don't have time to do the planning. Why not? Why weren't we in the planning years ago? We should have been. It just comes down to money. You're out of money, you spent all the money in the bigger communities, and now we get the crumbs. Are we not worth more than that? Are we not an important part of this state? Thank you for allowing me to make these comments.
Our next speaker to sign in on our elected local officials speaker sign in this evening will be Kevin Overmeyer, Marshall County Coroner's Office.
No, not the coroner. He just thought.
Okay.
At least he got my name right this time.
Apologize.
But I'd like to thank Ryan and Jack and Randy for being here tonight. I have a letter here from State Representative Bill Friend from Miami County I'd like to read. Hopefully it doesn't count against my 2 minutes since I have to read, since he can't be here tonight. Over the last 3 months, I, along with other state lawmakers and community leaders, have met with INDOT several times to discuss J-Turn Project's proposal on US 31. While INDOT has seen success in fewer crashes at US Highway 41 and State Road 114, where a J-Turn opened early last year, it is not a fair comparison. This J-turn makes for a poor example because it does not experience anywhere near the same volume of traffic as US Highway 31. As we move forward, I will continue to diligently remind INDOT that we hope that they will find and take a different course of action. It is clear that our community is strongly opposed to J-turns. Incorporating these J-turns will not suit the number and speed of vehicles traveling these highways. And in my opinion, are not the right step to ensure the safety of motorists on the roads. I want to thank INDOT for taking the time to not only listen to citizens' concerns, but also answer questions and other insight on what our community can expect over the next few years. In the past, INDOT has always been extremely receptive to public comments and has always been willing to listen and in some cases find a different course of action. I am confident that they will continue to consider our concerns and find the best solution for the intersections along U.S. Highway 31. I encourage everyone to continue voicing your concerns on J-turns to not only your state and local officials, but also the governor's office in INDOT. That was from State Representative Flynn. Also, you guys had some crash data up there for a 5-year period. This is crash data I got from ACOG, Michigan Area Council of Governments. This is from 13, 14, and 15. In that period of time, at State Road 10, there was 24 crashes, and at that same time, there was 14 at 110. Now, you should put up a 5-year period, and I think these numbers don't jive with what you're telling us. And I've been on, you know, US 31 has been brought up here to the coalition. Me and Roger Gross, who's a former commissioner in Fulton County, have been on that board for a long time. And that was always the intention of doing this US 31 was to make this a freeway. Not because of the time travel from South Bend to Indy, but because it was supposed to be an economic corridor. That's why this was proposed many, many years ago when Governor Kernan, and probably before Governor Kernan. So it's just not about the time. It's about the economics of this highway. This highway travels from the north part of the United States all the way to the southern part of the United States. You know, this intersection with US 30, two major highways that cross Marshall County. And you guys want to do this to these people here in Argos who are working very hard and diligently to support this town and bring economic impact to Marshall County and the northern part of the state. So I just, and I think my hats are off to Ryan and Jack and Randy and the other state legislators that fell on the knife, fell on the sword, and raised the gasoline tax to produce more revenue for the state of Indiana. And I don't think you guys are using it proportionately up here in the north, because I think your number one goal is to finish I-69 from Indianapolis to Evansville at a cost of $1 billion.
Commissioner, for those comments. Commissioner Obermeyer was actually the last elected official to sign in as a speaker. However, having heard our previous elected officials, perhaps there are other elected officials in our audience who would like an opportunity to present his or her comment for inclusion into the public record this evening. So before we transition to our general speakers list or our general speakers schedule this evening, I certainly want to afford an opportunity additional elected officials who might want an opportunity to present a comment this evening.
We're going to let former Roger Rose, Commissioner, speak for us.
Okay. All right, then we'll then transition to Roger Rose. Ms. Rose, the floor is now yours, sir.
Thank you. My name is Roger Rose. I am a former Fulton County Commissioner. I served 16 years in that capacity and retired as of first of the year, and has spent 15 of those years on the local plan commission for the county, and am very familiar with this intersection. I travel it very frequently, and I'm also the Fulton County representative to the US 31 Coalition. I did have some prepared comments that I had made that I was going to just to read, but based on the input I've got in the presentation, I think I'm going to put those aside. And I think I want to defer to the comments of Senator Head and Representative Jordan, because they very accurately reflect the sentiments of the Fulton County Commissioners, and by the way, I am speaking on their behalf. I have been very involved with the 31 Coalition for all these years, and I think they would like me to use that experience I've had doing that to kind of speak for how they see this proposed J-turn installation at 110 in terms of how it will affect us. The presentation we had here tonight by INDOT was very informative, but I think I disagree with a lot of the content. I think what Senator Head had said is that it does seem as though the minds have been made up in INDOT that they're going to do this, and they're going to just go ahead and dot the I's and cross the T's with public hearings, but there's a lot more to it than that. And in particular, I think one of the things that seems to, in your presentation, you seem to have glossed over very lightly was the effect on the local Mennonite population. I mean, yeah, I understand the horses and buggies are slow-moving vehicles, but they're more than that. They're very unique in that you're dealing with horses. And we have had a couple of incidents very near to the State Road 110 intersection in which the horses were spooked by one thing or another. And they literally bolted out in front of traffic, in front of actually two semis in one situation. And it was an absolute miracle that there was not a fatality involved with how this thing played out. But I think trying to have a horse and buggy negotiate, and we do have a very large and growing Mennonite population in northern Fulton County, southern Marshall County. They're on both sides of US 31, and that is a very big problem. Jumping from that, having been involved with the US 31 Coalition for about 5 years, I want to say that our planning for the upgrade that we have been told about goes back even many years before that. We actually started a local planning effort to try to anticipate the US 31 upgrade back as far as 2005. We heard there was the larger project was going on to the north and the south. As we began local planning efforts through the Plan Commission to put together a plan for this upgrade where we thought interchanges and overpasses should be and just how this thing would affect us. We wanted to have time working in our favor and to prepare a plan that we would be able to just hand the end on and say, here, we've done some of the work for you. This will speed up this whole planning process because we have done a little plus much of the legwork. We tried to present that plan at the meeting they had earlier this year, and I think we were very disappointed in that, yeah, they listened to our plan, but there just didn't seem to be the interest in listening to the local officials and taking advantage of the planning that we've done and taking that to heart. And in the context of this larger upgrade for 31, in particular, trying to do the J-turn installations, Fulton County needs to emphasize how important the upgrade of this highway is. As Kevin Obermeyer has very eloquently stated, this is a very important highway for it cuts through the center of the country, and it is really our economic lifeline to the rest of the world. And we want to see that thing upgraded. We've been planning for it for over 10 years, and we want to see INDOT show more interest in the work that we've done. And I think if you would try to incorporate some of the work that the local communities have done into your planning, you'd find that the planning time horizon for maybe some of these interchanges and overpasses that might help ease the traffic situation might be greatly reduced and make it a much more timely thing to increase safety. So with that, I would just like to add the Fulton County's collective voice in opposition to the J-turn installation at 110. We don't think that is an appropriate solution for the problem. We do want to see you incorporate interchange there as part of the long-term upgrade for US 31. We think that is the most cost-effective use of the limited funds that are available for highway improvements. And I guess I do want to thank you for being concerned about the safety of the highway as we travel through 31 in Fulton County. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rose, for those comments. Our next speaker decided, or our speaker scheduled this evening, will be Pat Lancet. Our next speaker to sign in on our speaker scheduled this evening will be Pat Lancet. As Ms. Lancet is making the
signed in, email address, our mailing address. We actually have combo forms this evening too, so if you'd like to submit a comment and hand it to any member of our INDOT team, all those comments will be certainly included in the official public hearings transcript. Ms. Lansing, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for your time and for allowing me to speak tonight. I just want to say ditto to everything that's been said tonight. My couple of concerns I have, I also am concerned about the Mennonite and the Amish communities. I think forcing them to spend more time on US 31 is a dangerous idea for them. I just think, especially as the former presenter mentioned, horses, you're dealing with an animal with its own brain, and sometimes I'm worried that spending more time physically on 31, even though it's supposed to be on the edge, gives more time for those horses to be spooked by oncoming traffic and more opportunities for accidents to happen for them. I'm very, very concerned about those folks. They are a very vibrant part of our community and a growing part. I also am concerned about the semis. Even though you say there's a way for them to get around, I just think going across those lanes of traffic is going to be an issue with the speed that people are going north and south on 31. I'm not convinced that there's a safety improvement there. I'm just really concerned about that whole issue. I applaud those who have spoken. I agree with everything, especially the representatives who have spoken. I appreciate their comments. A couple of questions I have concerning signaling lights. Is it possible as an alternative to put signaling lights at 110 and State Road 10 that have sensors in them so that they would only change to allow east-west traffic when there actually is east and west traffic that needs to go across? So the north and south traffic wouldn't stop unless there are cars that actually need to go east and west. I don't see that as ever being presented as an option. But that would also decrease the possibility of accidents and hopefully increase safety, because those lights wouldn't change unless there was a need for them to change. So I present that as an option. I also am concerned as well. I guess I'm as skeptical as some of the others that have spoken at this mic. I've also heard from folks that it seems like this is a done deal, that you guys have already decided. I know you say this is supposed to be a proposal, but everybody I'm talking to locally says they feel like it's a done deal. And I'd like to know who has given INDOT the power to go against the entire community, including local and state officials, to make this decision, even though everybody, including the officials, are against it. Thank you very much.
And I'll mention briefly, we've had members of our team manning the foyer area, so if there are specific questions, during the comment session, it's important that we capture comments so that they can be transcribed, so we need to capture those as accurately as possible. But if you do have questions, if you'd like to have a conversation, we have members of our team who are in the foyer throughout the entire evening to certainly entertain questions. And then at the conclusion of the comment session, all members of the INDOT team will be in the foyer area and will entertain questions at that particular time. So again, Ms. Lansing, thank you for those comments. We have additional speakers who have signed in on our speaker schedule, and then we suspect that maybe others who might want to participate. So we certainly want to make sure that we accommodate all of our speakers who have signed in this evening. Our next speaker on our schedule this evening will be Doug Middleton. Will be our next speaker on our speaker schedule. So Doug Middleton in the audience. There he is. Very well. And again, as I mentioned at the conclusion of the comment session, all the members of the INDOT team will be in the foyer area and certainly entertain questions at that time. Mr. Middleton, the floor is now yours, sir.
I promise, no zingers this time. I'm Doug Middleton. I'm going to ask the same question a little bit different than what I did last week. Anybody not with INDOT that's for the J-turns, please stand up. We have one person for the J-turns this time. Thank you. Crossroads of America, Indiana, not J Turn of America. It was spoken tonight that we're stakeholders. We are, but we're shareholders. It's our tax money that are building these roads. So we have a twofold in our hands here. We have over 1,000 signatures against J Turns. Probably left of that actually. The town of Culver has adopted a negative proposal, voted on it. We have township trust or township people to state level, US 31 coalition against. We'll pick on Doug Motz just a little bit. I don't want to single anybody out, like I said earlier, it's not anything personal. But Doug said in a statement back in June in Cass County that if we get enough opposition, we will look at another way. From the lowest of local to the highest of the state, you have opposition. I think it's time to go back to the drawing board. I know we have at least one teacher or administrator, Mr. Lichty here. Is a 50% a passing grade in school?
No.
A 50% is not a passing grade in school. We ask our kids from the time they're little till the time they graduate college to give everything 100%, whether it's in sports, school, do their best. And the best you guys can come up with is a 50% reduction in fatalities at these intersections. That's not a passing grade in my book either. So we're not asking you, INDOT, to do any more than what we do from our elementary age kids to our college kids. There's less people this week than there was a week ago, and I do believe that's because Doug said on TV, this is a very, very good chance this is going in. Again, iterating that simply going through the motions. He said that emergency services would take 30 to 60 seconds. I went out in a fire truck in the evening with no traffic, basically. We did it. It took me 53 seconds, closer to a minute. So you're going to add a minute up here at 10, and then when I get down to 110, you're going to add another minute. So that's 2 minutes to negotiate those two terms. When John can also, being a fireman, can also agree every second counts when it comes to a life. Every minute a fire doubles twice, twofold a fire situation. I believe the correct word should be eliminate, not reduce. That's all I have. Thank you.
Mr. Middleton, his comments. Our next speaker to sign in on our schedule this evening, wanting his or her comment entered into the official public record, will be Tim Hackett. Our next speaker on our schedule this evening will be Tim Hackett. Mr. Hackett, the floor is now yours, sir.
Gentlemen, this is your third trip to Marshall County in Argos to sell this plant. It has not been well received. It's not selling. Information indicates you've been to Miami County as well. The information I have is it didn't sell down there either. If I put forth a plan that had that much public opposition, I think I'd go back to Detroit. This is a good example here of government functioning in opposition to the will of the people.
That's right.
You ought to rethink this and look at it again and listen to what people are telling you. And it is a done deal. I think we all understand that. You understand that. You're just down here to sell the program. It's not selling. Pay attention.
Thank you.
Those comments. Our next speaker to sign in on our schedule this evening will be Steve Metzger. Our next speaker to sign in on our schedule this evening requesting an opportunity to present his or her comment into the official record will be Steve Metzger. Again, for all of our previous speakers, again, feel free to supplement your verbal comments with written statements, and I'll also mention that at the conclusion of the comment session, all the members of our team will be available in the foyer area to entertain questions, point out areas of clarification in the open house session. Mr. Metzger, the floor is yours, sir.
Thank you, everybody. I'm a county commissioner from Fall County. I did get on the blue list, but tonight I'm going to wear my farmer hat because I'm a farmer and I have to cross the road a lot and travel. I use 3105 and I think it's a bad deal for the semis. It's not long enough for acceleration, crossing, negotiating traffic, to turn around, in my opinion. And I would just like to, a lot of comments that I've heard, that everybody thinks that this is temporary, and I'm not for sure, I haven't studied it long enough, but if it's temporary, I would just say, leave it be until we have the money or the funding to do it right, put in a nice interchange. And I'd like to thank all the other people that have done all the planning previously, and I'm kind of new to the game, so I'd like to thank everybody for their comments, and everything's been covered, so thank you.
Our next speaker to sign in on our schedule this evening Al Sullivan. Our next speaker to sign in on our schedule requesting an opportunity to present a comment and have that comment entered into the official record will be Al Sullivan. And I'll mention quickly, Mr. Sullivan actually is the last speaker to sign in. However, having heard from all of our previous speakers and many others in our audience, it certainly will afford an opportunity for others to participate as speakers this evening. Mr. Sullivan, the floor is yours.
Like you're talking out there, my Huyans up there, when they was chopping up there at Cindy's restaurant, their silage trailer and their tractor set out in there. Traffic was backed up completely to Cindy's because there wasn't enough room for that stuff to set. I know that's up there, but here. Merle Haynes set out here at 10 and 31 for 20 minutes on a night at Notre Dame. A state cop seen him and finally stopped traffic and let him across, and he sat there in a semi for 20 minutes. He could not get across. A farmer just gone out here, that planter and tractor, he's got them triples. That thing's 80-some feet long. When you go down them roads, there's not enough room, and the cars that's running on 31, most of them don't know what us farmers, our stuff don't go the speed their sports cars do. Notre Dame had a ball game out here the other night, and it was at McDonald's. The traffic was backed up, Curta, Dollar General. There was a semi coming through there with one lane or some, they turned their four ways on. They actually stopped. Now, that ain't very safe, but they was courteous enough, they stopped to let it clean out the cars and stuff out there on traffic. The combines are like 23 feet wide. You got them reflectors out there. When we can only get over so far, they're not my combines, but people at Farm on Farm and stuff have them that wide. And that's now, that ain't in the future. You get there, they're running her out in them other lanes again. Them people don't realize what farm equipment is. I live in the middle of horse and buggies down there. The Mennonites is where they're at down there, and the buggies and stuff in there. And them horses, you can't believe until you live. We used to go to Napa Day and you'll see them. You never seen that. When you live down here, the messes that them horses spook, there's some damn rides. I'm glad I ain't in their buggies. There's 12 to 15 at a time. We don't care about your 14 and 1 or 114 and 41 and stuff, you know, your stuff out there. This is our community. That ain't our community down there. There's a feed lady that would get feed off of down here. Her quad axle trucks, she hauls to Michigan. She can't make your them J turns in Michigan. She has to back up her feed. That's not very safe for a driver to back up to get in this lane when there's cars coming down through there. And it was mentioned that I live right there by 110, and there was a girl killed down, or a kid killed down there and stuff like that at 110. And then, like, when we got a baler, we got a load of hay and stuff, if we're supposed to come and get on that, we can't see what the traffic's coming up behind us for us to cross to get over to that stuff, and we farm on both sides down through there and stuff like that. And I guess, like, on us from a business side, we wouldn't build a 10,000 bushel bin if we know in 5 years we're going to rent a bunch more ground and we need a 50,000 bushel bin. We're going to make other arrangements. You can go build one and tear it down in 5 years and build another, and that's just a waste of money. That is our
statements against you. You said that the J turns can handle
up to 5.5 times more volume than what we have currently on US 31. So I ask you, why did Carmel, Westfield, Kokomo, South Bend, places like that not get these interchanges? They're supposedly cheaper, they're faster to build, they handle higher traffic volumes than what we currently have here. You act like 31 just stops out here in the middle of the country somewhere. 31 goes from South Bend, clear to Indianapolis. The traffic flow doesn't change. It's the same. So I'm asking you, why did these communities not get these intersections? They're cheaper. Can save tax dollars. So I know you're not addressing questions here, but it's in the record.
Yep.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Additional speakers who would like to participate this evening during our public comment session, I see a hand at the very back. May I be so kind as to make your way forward to the front of the auditorium. And again, for all of our speakers, first of all, thank you to our audience for courtesy paying to all of our speakers thus far. For our speakers, again, supplementing your verbal comments with written statements as well. And then at the conclusion of this evening, we'll have members of our team in the foyer area to entertain questions. And if you would be so kind as to state your first and last name, the floor is yours.
My name is Shannon Cameras. And as you can see, I'm a healthcare worker. I travel this road every day in order to provide safety in a hospital setting. I travel 31. I go down these roads. I see how people travel down these roads. They don't drive 60. They drive 70, 75, 80, 90 down these roads. I travel them every day. I've talked to several coworkers, and some of them are from Maryland, some of them are from Michigan, and they call these J-turns, junk turns. That is the slang that they use for these. Last week I talked about emergency vehicles, about adding 30 seconds. That's fine. So you've got somebody going, let's say, west. They make a J-turn, and they continue going west. That adds 30 seconds. But what you're not taking into account for is them coming back so they can go to the hospital. You've got another 30 seconds so that that person has a chance of surviving. Doug, last week you were on Channel 16. You pretty much said it was a done deal. I can play it back. It was on TV. So being that it's a done deal, you had a revision of the INDOT manual back in January of 17. You had the J-turns down in 114 2 years ago. You did not address J-turns in your manuals. So people don't even know how to come to a four-way stop sign and make a correct turn. How do you expect them to do the J-turn without any education? Missouri, I looked up all the states who suggested. Missouri is the only state in their manuals that addresses J-turns, and it is 2 sentences of a paragraph. Thank you for your time.
Well, thank you, Ms. Collins. Do we have additional speakers who would like an opportunity to present their comment and have it entered into the official public record? Having heard from our speakers this evening, perhaps there's someone else in our audience who would like an opportunity to participate. Certainly don't want to overlook anyone. Do we have additional speakers at this time? Not seeing any hands, then I will assume that many of you will have specific questions. And so certainly that's one of the purposes for tonight's public hearing. The school's been very gracious to us, and they're going to allow us to be here this evening for as long as you would like us to be. Every member of the INDOT team will be available in the foyer area to answer questions or to have conversations. I'll mention briefly before we adjourn, we have plenty and plenty of copies of the information, so if you know folks that could not make it this evening, by all means, feel free to take additional copies for them. Also, the information is all posted on our website this evening, so perhaps you'd like to take a closer look after tonight. And so again, we'll make a final call for any speakers. Right, very well. If I don't see any additional hands, then that just means that we've got lots and lots of questions, and so that's fantastic. So this time, we'll adjourn the formal session but that doesn't mean that the evening is over. We're going to be available in the foyer area. Please stay after. Please talk with members of our team. Pick up copies of the information. We have a video and some other things that are out in the foyer as well. Thank you so very much, everyone, for your time this evening, and please stay after.